It's finally happened. Nvidia has once again remembered that graphics cards under $300 exist so that they can disappoint people in that space as well. Well, in all fairness to Nvidia, they have been making increasingly terrible versions of the 3050, so I guess they have been doing that, but at least with this one, they're trying to make it better. But before we check it out, today's video is sponsored by your monthly reminder that if you want to save big, go to Micro Center. In August, they're running their Build Upgrade Save event, where you can save huge amounts on pretty much any component to build your own system, like a 7800X3D for $340. Also, Phoenix, Arizona, at some point in the future, you're getting a Micro Center, so sign up for VIP deals and a free 128GB flash drive when the store opens. And then finally, if you're a Micro Center member, save on already great prices for some Samsung NVMe drive action using the links down below at Micro Center. Now, when it comes to the specs, as is tradition with the 50 series, it seems, on paper, we're off to a terrible start with the 5050. These are the number of various bits of core in the new 50 card, and these numbers have been seared into my memory because they have been identical for the last three generations of 50 GPU, be it laptop or desktop, not including all of the weird cutdown abominations, of course. And then when it comes to memory, we have a number that's more triggering to the average PC gamer than Mountain Dew inflation. This 8 gigs is a big problem for the 5050. Now, I know that in the last video where I spoke about Nvidia GPUs, I was actually pretty excited about the laptop 5050 having 8 gigs of video memory, but that's because budget laptop gamers have been so cocked by Nvidia up until this point that even that is a huge sign of good faith from Nvidia to them. But with desktop graphics cards, it's very different. Especially considering that at least one of the graphics cards I'm going to compare the 5050 to later in the video has quite a bit more video memory. But with that, let's not get too caught up in what it says on the 5050's spec sheet. Because you know, architectural improvements are a thing. So let's drop it in a system, see how it performs, then we'll compare it to its own predecessor, which I'll remind you is a two-generation-old GPU at this point, and then we'll see how it compares to its real competition from the other companies. As is tradition, we're starting with CS2 to see what kind of esports performance we're getting from this at 1080p. It's probably going to be really good, considering that esports can run on my colon. And yeah, look at that. We've got hundreds of frame rates happening. And interestingly, in this context, it seems like the CPU and the GPU are a really good pairing for each other, because it's rare to see 100-ish% utilization in CS2. So that's cool, 7600X3D putting in work. And it was at this point that I realized that the game was actually running at 1440p low settings. And when I switched over to 1080p, we gained a lot of frame rate and still maintained our 100% GPU utilization, which is cool. Oh wow, it actually by default sets Fidelity FX up for some reason, despite the fact that we've got an Nvidia card in here. But look at that. In the mid 80s, very good. I mean, we're even jumping up to 90 sometimes. Like, the game feels good at 1080p high. I guess it means that we can scale up to some ray tracing at 1080p. So I'm gonna leave it at high, and then in here, I'm gonna turn ray tracing on with medium, I guess. We probably want ray traced reflections, right? That's like the minimum, surely. Wow, it's dropped a lot. We are hovering around 30 frames per second now, and it feels pretty rubbish for 30 frames per second, but I guess it just feels that terrible because of the stark contrast to the 90 frames per second we were getting earlier. We do have resolution scaling, so we're gonna do transformer model DLSS, and we'll just do quality. Okay, so we have doubled our frame rate using just quality DLSS, and the game looks a little bit smoothed over. Like, you can tell that it's on, but it's running way better. Which meant it was time to go balls to the wall, really max out ray tracing so that we can test out the one feature that Nvidia won't shut up about. But first, let's see what happens without frame gen. Very not good stuff. About 8 frames per second with around, oh, suddenly our frame rate jumped from 8 to 20 frames per second without anything obvious changing. I think maybe that jump had to do with Windows sorting out like memory allocation. Maybe, don't quote me on that. So now we're gonna do what I imagine Nvidia wants us to do with the settings. And we're gonna turn DLSS on, transformer model, with quality settings. And then we're just gonna go straight to 4x multi-frame gen. Yeah, it's a wonderful technology. Wow, 60 frames per second at 1080p is happening. You can see that our frame time graph is nice and smooth, which is what we're looking for. 1080p kind of high settings modern games seems to be working pretty well, even without upscaling. And in terms of power draw through these tests, the 5050 was hovering at about 110 to 120 watts, which is pretty efficient considering the performance we're getting, but we'll compare that to the other graphics cards later. I then wanted to see what happens at 1440p. Oh, things fall apart real fast at 1440p. We've gone from 60 frames per second at 1080p to like 17 at 1440p. And then something happens. I think, again, this is Windows coming in and saving us because the frame rate just jumped up to 30 frames per second. Ooh, so this is us barebacking Stalker 2 at 1080p, medium settings, and it's about 62 frames per second. And the thing is, this is actually a kind of usable Stalker experience. The frame time graph is smooth enough that it's feeling reasonable aside from that stutter and that stutter. Having said that, like, the moment you like quick movement happens, it's not great. I did also quickly want to see what a splash of DLSS does to the experience. Although you can't really do just a splash of DLSS on Stalker 2 because it just immediately hits you with 66% resolution scale. In fact, if you are a developer of Stalker 2 and you're watching this video, I know that's extremely unlikely, but please unlock this so that we can kind of manually set our resolution scale. I don't know how possible something like that is in this engine, but it would be great if we can set like 75% or something. And just like that, there's a lot more frame rate and the game is, yeah, it's very playable now. But with that, let's put this performance into context by comparing the 5050 to other graphics cards, starting off with the GPUs, I guess, that it's replacing, the RTX 3050. Now, when looking at the 8GB version of the 3050, which I'd say is the direct predecessor of the 5050, we are getting a solid uplift in performance here, but granted, there are two generations between these GPUs, so the 3050 really isn't the 5050's main competitor. And then when moving over to the 6GB version of the 3050, I mean, they really should have called that graphics card something else. That performance delta is massive. And things get shocking when you move over to 1440p, where the 6GB is just completely inadequate. That poor graphics card's just drowning at this point. Which, I don't know, gets me real excited for the inevitable 6GB version of the 5050. Now, the first non-NVIDIA graphics card I'm going to compare the 5050 to is this, an AMD RX 7600. A graphics card you can buy new for about the same amount as the 5050. Now, a couple of things here. Unfortunately, this also only has 8GB of video memory, which is a pretty big bummer. And it's a generation older than the 5050. We're still waiting for AMD's current gen competitor to the 5050, but surely that means the 5050 is gonna have a real easy time of it, right? Wow, we are getting big, big frame numbers here, but I think we're running into a CPU wall. So this is probably gonna be very similar to the 5050 result. Yeah, at 1080p, the performance is functionally identical. However, when you step up to 1440p to try and diminish that CPU bottleneck, the delta isn't that big. However, it's in favor of the 7600, which is a little bit awkward for the 5050. With Cyberpunk, however, I immediately ran into a bit of a problem with the 7600. Well, the 5050 didn't crash, so that is a difference. And this kept happening. I couldn't get a benchmark result for Cyberpunk at 1080p. What is this? Counts as a forfeit? I'm not sure. Okay, I don't know how long we're gonna be able to play this for, but it seems like we are getting around the same performance as the 5050. What is interesting is that the 5050 definitely has the efficiency upper hand because, well, we're drawing about 180 here, which is almost 70 watts more than the 5050. Interestingly, Cyberpunk's canned benchmark didn't crash at 1440p for some reason, so at least we have one comparative result for this game. And here again, the 5050's trading blows with a generation-old graphics card. I then tried some ray tracing at 1080p on the 7600. I think this is about what happened with the 5050 as well. But look at the frame time graph. That is a difference. We are getting huge fluctuations in frame rate, and it's really visible. Like, it's almost rubber banding in the way that it's presenting the frames. The graphics card's not happy with what's going on here. But again, that could be due to the fact that apparently my card has leprosy. I've been talking about leprosy a lot lately. I've clearly got it on the brain at the moment for some reason. Ooh, okay, so with Doom the Dark Ages, the 7600 does seem to be struggling a little bit. So this, again, is 1080p high. And, I mean, we're getting to 60. It's slowly building up the confidence to get us to the point that we were with the little 5050. It definitely seems like the 7600 doesn't like ray tracing, because here with Doom the Dark Ages, it falls a reasonable bit behind the 5050. However, this lead reverses when you jump up to 1440p, but when you don't factor in the initial seizure that the 5050 has at 1440p, then they're about the same. It is looking, on the surface, pretty similar to what we were seeing with the 5050. We're running at around 60 frames per second, and the frame time graph is reasonably stable. In fact, their average is exactly the same, although the 7600 seems a little bit more stable with a slightly higher 1% low, but these two results are functionally identical, which is also the case at 1440p. Okay, so it's not great for the 5050 that its performance is functionally identical to a two-year-old graphics card that kinda wasn't that exciting 2 years ago. But it gets worse, because the 7600 is arguably not the biggest threat to the 5050, because it also needs to deal with this, the Intel B580, and it has 12 gigs of video memory. Oh, that's not a great start. Now, the little B580 is not a happy chappy when it comes to CS2 for some reason. Now, don't get me wrong, we're getting hundreds of frame rates, obviously, but it's gonna be quite a bit lower than what we've seen with the other two GPUs that we've tested today. So the main threat isn't starting off too great in CS2. It's still a usable result, but it's much lower than the other two. And even moving up to 1440p doesn't help its case much. But don't worry, things get way better in the other games. Now, straight off the bat, at 1080p, it is not looking good for the 5050, because with our B580, we're getting about 100 frames per second. And in fact, in the canned benchmark, it went from about 90 frames per second to over 100, which is a big step up. 1080p is not a resolution that the B580 really shines at. This graphics card only comes alive at 1440p. Another thing that's interesting about this result is that the power draw is basically the same. So in terms of efficiency, the 5050 doesn't even have that going for it.
And at 1440p, the B580 does in fact leave the other two GPUs in the dust. I then decided to see what ray tracing does.
And it's performing better than the 5050 did. Because we have so much more frame rate to work with, it doesn't drop as hard as it did on that graphics card. Now at 1080p, with Doom the Dark Ages, it's not looking super promising for the B580.
At 1080p, the B580 falls right in the middle of the pack here. But again, 1440p is where it gets interesting.
Wow, yeah, the B580 does really like 1440p. This is the first of the three graphics cards that feels almost playable at 1440p. I wouldn't want to play it like this, but if we just use a little bit of Fidelity FX, it's gonna be a very playable experience.
Ooh, yeah, that number's quite a lot bigger there.
Yeah, 50 frames per second-ish. So this is the worst performing of the three graphics cards so far.
So that's another weakness of the B580. It has quite big game-to-game variance. However, in its wheelhouse, it does a good job closing the gap between it and the other graphics cards. With that, let me know down below what you think of how the 5050 compares to the other graphics cards in its price point. And do you think it holds up better or worse than the other 50 series cards have held up so far this year? Also, subscribe to the channel on the way down to the comment section, and until the next video, thank you for watching. Bye-bye.